Here we go. Woo! All right. Big Mug. Big Mug Zoom coming at you.
We seem to be ready.
Whoa, my camera stays in focus a lot better these days. Oh, now as I say it, it goes out. Mm-hmm. All right. Can everybody see us? Check this out. We're on. Good morning.
I think we broke the internet.
We almost did. Apparently, we got the squirrels properly fed. They have canceled their mutiny, and they are running.
Awesome.
Well, they're Canadian squirrels, so we forgot to feed them in metric this time around. They're fussy.
They felt shorted.
Yeah. A metric peanut is like 1.6 of an imperial peanut, and we always forget the conversion.
Dang it.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Hey, you guys in the chat, thank you so much for hanging out with us. Holy smokes. That was an interesting moment in these times of trial.
Interesting. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. On our side, we've tried a couple of times and two or three times it said, nope. Literally, the message said, sorry, can't. I have a headache. Not today, it was saying something like that.
And we got kicked a few times as well. Yeah.
Yeah. We got bumped out of the green room trying to get in. We had to figure. And I know that Sierra from our team was messaging in Teams in the background that she was having trouble even getting into the session to log into the site. So, oh, well, yeah.
So, excellent tip then right off the bat. If you're going to be doing this kind of webinar online thing while you're sheltering in place and teaching online, you should have a producer in the background that can be very helpful for you when this happens.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. If you're thinking of including webinar type things in your learning ecosystem, see what I did there.
Oh.
Becky's saying, I think it's all Chris since he's fuzzy wuzzy. I'm not bear. I'll tell you that. I have a shirt on. So,
and he is here. He's not there.
That's right. Was he? Waka, waka, waka.
Oh, no. Wait a minute.
We'll wait for it.
Okay. Oh, shoot. I had it turned down.
Oh, no.
Dang it. Oh, because that's still going. Well,
there we go. As Brent was saying, it's sometimes good to have a producer in the background of your webinar.
Never try to produce your own.
That's right.
There we go. Now we're in. We're talking about ecosystems, but who's our guest today, Chris?
We have the wonderful, the beautiful, the effervescent Derek Redmond joining us today, all the way from Oshawa, Washington. Where the heck did that come from? I know why, because
they're pretty close.
Conversation about Redmond, Washington, right?
There it is. Yeah. Yeah. They're pretty close.
Yeah. Joining us all the way from the beautiful Oshawa, Ontario, just down the 401 from the center of the universe.
Or so we think.
Yeah. So it thinks. Technically, you're not in it, right? I mean, yeah, you can reserve that. So this is some Canadian Toronto bashing, which is actually one of our national pastimes here in Canada.
It's true.
It is. Yeah. Exactly. So, Derek, let's take a second to give you a chance to introduce yourself to the folks who joined us. Tell us a little bit about your background, and then we'll get rolling in today's conversation.
Sure. Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. That was the most compliment I've ever received. So that was a beautiful part. Like, that's awesome. So myself,
they're all in the cue card that you sent us.
It's true. I work for a company called Point Click Care. I'm an instructional designer and educational technology specialist. In Point Click Care, we work in the long-term care, post-acute industry in both the United States and Canada, providing solutions for them, electronic medical records and other solutions as well. So my role there is just creating content for staff to support them in doing their jobs, essentially. So that's where I currently am.
Yeah. Yeah, cool. And you have a previous background in directly in the healthcare space too.
Yeah,
right? Instructional design.
I used to work at Baycrest Health Sciences. It's a geriatric hospital in Toronto. And I was there for about three years. Yeah. And previous to that, I was at Ontario Shores Center for Mental Health, which is just in Whippy. And I was also there for about three and a half years.
Nice. And you are also part of the organizing committee, if we'll call it that, for the Canadian e-learning conference.
I'm the director.
Go ahead.
Director of Vendor Relations there as well, Canadian e-learning conference, which we sadly had to cancel this year due to COVID-19. We were really, really looking forward to it.
Yeah, that's always held in downtown Toronto. And we've been to it. Me and dominKnow a few times, and it's a really great lineup and a fabulous venue. And it, I really like it for the intimacy, I would describe, of it. Yeah. Like it's a very warm and conversational. It doesn't, you know, you're not spread out all over the place. So it's really a really neat, unique experience. So
yeah, it's not so big that you don't get to meet everybody. Mm-hmm. It's big enough, but small enough where you really get to have some good networking with folks. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and Cindy says great food. Yeah, that is a highlight too. Yeah, the first year when they rolled out the skewers and stuff, and I went, "Whoa, this is conference food? It's not in a box. What's going on?"
No, it's gourmet. It's
gourmet. No kidding. No, the conference fabulous that it keeps growing every year, and it's always very, very, very well put together. So kudos to you and the gang on that front. So yeah.
Thanks so much.
So we're talking learning ecosystems here today. And we have this controversial title. I don't know. We're all about the controversial titles today. Dump your training strategy for a learning ecosystem. So, and I mean, hey, a conference could also be part of a learning ecosystem, I guess, in some angles, et cetera. And we were chatting just before the session, we were chatting a little bit about how we all kind of really like that, the term learning ecosystem for a number of reasons. And maybe let's just start with what your reasons are then for liking that term learning ecosystem to get started.
Sure. I mean, it's really all encompassing, looking at a very high level overview of everything that can affect learning at your organization, from the technology that might be involved, to the content that's involved, to all the people that are involved, and set within the context of your organizational policies, even funding, and things external to your organization. So people or content and skills that people are bringing in from university and college courses, they're bringing in those skills and knowledge into your organization and affecting your organization. Government policies and legislation that require a certain thing. So it's just really, really high level overview. It gives you a good map of what learning looks like at your organization. It allows you to see relationships between how things affect one another, and gives you a good strategic point as to where you can really, really make good decisions.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I like about the term is it also reminds us that it's an interconnectedness of things, pulling from the ecosystem, the world of biology, et cetera, and that it's not just something. Also, it's not just something monolithic like singularly an LMS or singularly, one place or one thing as well. It reminds us that stuff is all over in a sense, and it's all part of the whole.
Exactly. I mean, it comes from the idea of biological ecosystems. If you've watched Planet Earth, they talk about it all the time. You know, you're looking at the jungles, and they talk about, you remove that one thing or add that one thing, and you can see this just complete change in how the entire ecosystem is. And it's taking that kind of same perspective into your organization to see how things are affecting learning.
Mm-hmm, for sure.
I like the term because it also has a sense of including the wetware, right? Our brains, the people, right? And the culture, right? So when you think about a learning ecosystem, you could think about it mostly from the tech side and the technologies that are inside of the organization, but the learning also that happens up here and between individuals in the office. So culture plays a role. Just like if you pulled out one particular piece of technology, that might have a trickle-down effect. If you pulled out a few people and put in a few new people, that kind of shifts that ecosystem too a little bit. So it's the whole entire thing is not something that we normally focus on or have conversations about.
Definitely. I mean, if let's say you have a role of somebody who's just an LMS administrator and they're doing a lot of the reporting functions for the organization. If you take that person out, there goes the entire reporting function for the organization. So it's how people, the jobs they do, but also the skills and the knowledge that they bring the organization and how that affects everything. Yeah.
Hmm. And that was the comment about same things affecting. I went, oh yeah, that's, I hadn't thought of it. I hadn't extended the metaphor mentally, you know, out to that level of, yeah, you take something out or you put something new in.
Yeah.
And then there are ripple effects or other, other things that then occur as a result of that too. Yeah.
Yeah. And again, not even just internal to the organization, but if you're working for a hospital, for example, and government funding gets cut, how is that going to affect learning at your organization, what you can put out, and maybe the staff that you have, all of that. So it's not just internal to your organization.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. All the external forces that act on the business and the individuals, and I mean, you even keep continuing to stretch it out to everybody's got their own family situation, right? And if something happens, you know, for them, their focus on the business can change a little bit. That can impact everything. How does the culture, how does everything shift, and how does everything change? Or if there's a global pandemic of some sort, and everybody has to start working from home all of a sudden, so sometimes that would impact the ecosystem.
Yeah, geez, Brent, would you stop reading those science fiction books?
I know.
That'll never happen.
That'll never happen.
Crazy me.
Yeah.
So what do we look at? Like, I'm thinking, let's do... We've gone really high and expanded really wide, but let's pull it back down just a little bit, something a little bit more tactical for us. And if we're thinking about learning ecosystems, maybe we can start with, like, what tech does a company typically already have that could be part of that learning ecosystem?
I would say for most organizations, we're at the LMS stage. Like, we mostly have an LMS. So if you're looking at the tech, you might have, so your LMS is central, providing a lot of that content, maybe the scheduling of in-class content. You might have your HRIS system, which is providing the employee profiles. You might have your, maybe you use Active Directory for authenticating to log in, single sign-on perhaps into a learning management system. And perhaps you might have a separate analytics system that is trying to pull information from the LMS and analyze that, or it's within your LMS itself. So I think for most people at the technology side, that's where most organizations are at.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think some people still haven't quite thought of all those other technologies that can be used as part of the learning ecosystem. Mm-hmm. And one of the easiest ones, I think, is email gets skipped a lot, right? People stop thinking about that because it's like everybody likes to bash on email. Oh, it's old school. You should use Slack. You should do this. You just shouldn't even use email. It's just horrible, you know, and everybody kind of bashes on it. But yet 90% of the people out there still live and die by what's in their inbox.
Yep.
And it's always surprising to me that we as learning professionals don't take more advantage of that. And I don't mean take advantage of it by like plugging all sorts of learning stuff into everybody's inbox, but just every time some sort of message goes out or something, you know, why can't we just kind of put a little widget in of some sort that teaches people something, or maybe it reminds them to think about something. I don't know.
Yeah. Or it links to something that might not necessarily live in an LMS, which is good. It's funny. You mentioned email earlier today. I was rereading my paper to refamiliarize myself with the conversation today. There's part in there talking about the data architecture and what would be required as part of data architecture, one of those being data logistics. And I was trying to bring some of these things really, really back to basics of, even if you don't really have any, I would say, advanced technology, one of your methods of data logistics, that being moving data around the ecosystem itself, might be email. You might be manually sending Excel reports around to people, and that would actually be an example of a really basic data logistics.
Yeah, for sure. And so what else? Like, what else do we have? So if we've got email systems, most companies have an internal, I want to call it like a social media system or something. I mean, they used to call it what, enterprise social media?
You might have like a Yammer type page, even Microsoft Teams or Skype or any of those systems as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I wonder, are there good examples out there of how people use those in differently than their LMS? Like, can we do more than just build courses and stick them into the LMS?
Of course. it's a very loaded question. LMSs typically lend themselves well to the administration of learning, and it lends itself well to the traditional e-learning, if you think of it that way. But I mean, there might be many types of activities or authoring tools, if you will, they might be using that shouldn't necessarily live in an LMS. You might have a VR or AR experience that don't really want that perhaps to live in an LMS. So it's thinking to the learning experience for each thing that you're trying to roll out and saying, what's the best way to actually host whatever solution you're creating?
Mm-hmm. We're just getting some comments in the chat. People are as we expect, always jumping in. Stephanie was noting, I want to start an email drip course, and those are her quotes, at our organization. Yeah. And I was actually, a few years ago, Dr. Will Talheimer was doing something, and it was largely email based, and it wasn't like a newsletter, but it was a structured thing. It was related to his work in spaced learning, but yep. And it was just a simple thing. It was not super complicated, etc. But I'd signed up for that just to see, well, what's the good doctor doing here? And it was literally just running emails out, and then sometimes you were being linked to other things, etc. But yeah. That was the delivery mechanism, and it was very effective. In for the model of what he was what he's doing. Yeah, subscription learning. That was the thing.
Did have a name for it.
Yeah. and a lot of the problems with how organizations have their system set up right now is if you do something like an email drip or the subscription learning, and you have content also in your LMS, there may not be interoperability between the two systems that you're using. So you might have now learning content in two different systems, which definitely creates a challenge.
Well, and this is where XAPI comes into the conversation, I guess. We would be remiss if we did not even mention the acronym that is,
Sweep of the Nation.
It's one of the problems that it was trying to solve in the original days when they first started thinking about trying to solve that LMS problem, or the data problem, I guess I should say. Then the interoperability problem was, how do we come up with a super easy way to get all these other learning, platforms platforms that can be used as learning to deliver learning content? How do we track that? And how do we know that? Because people are only learning this much of their learning ecosystem is the LMS, and then they do all these other activities that actually contribute to their learning. So how do we track all of that to get a better idea, a more holistic view of that? Mm-hmm. And so that's for those of you maybe who are new to XAPI, because I'm still running into people on a regular basis that are like, X what?
Yeah. And Christopher Yellen's throwing a note in the chat, or don't bother tracking it. If you track results, that's how you know it worked, not by completions, which is, absolutely. I mean, that's always the goal, is to know that you're creating something as a change or improvement, et cetera. Otherwise we don't have actually a role in the workplace learning space. That's what we're here for. So.
Yeah. And I mean, there's API, and of course there's also another acronym, LTI, which is, just more acronyms for the industry.
Right. Well, yeah. this also expands our role, I believe, as developers and as instructional designers, because as we look at the ecosystem as a whole, I think it becomes very obvious that we can create more media and more content than just courses, right? I mean, when I first got into this industry, legitimately, the only thing that instructional designers were trained to create were classroom-based courses. Everything was student-teacher handouts. You train an instructor. The instructor goes into a classroom, and you create two products, the teacher guide and the student guides, mm-hmm. and maybe some interactive activities with some other elements and stuff, you know, and then you'd package it in a box and send it to somebody, and they would have all the stuff in it they needed to teach the course. And that, yeah. but that was it, right? I mean, that was all we had to do as instructional designers was get good at doing that. And now it's like the whole entire digital world has opened up to us, and it's like, I think it's overwhelming for a lot of folks. Mm-hmm.
It is. And coming to interoperability, there's so many APIs and specifications out there. I think the industry, it's been struggling a bit to try and create a standardized spec for everything.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I guess that was the point of XAPI and LTI. I see Rick mentioned their TLA, which I'm assuming that's Total Learning Architecture from ADL. If Rick can confirm, that's what he meant by that one. But yeah, it's, you know, what the heck do we use?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's certainly the, yeah. I, what are we tracking? What does it matter what we're tracking? We have to have an understanding of the value of that. Three letter acronyms, TLA.
Of nice. Course, TLA. Yeah.
Nice. That's
three letter acronyms that also mean multiple things as well.
That's right. Oh, it's like a Rorschach. You know, what do you see in this acronym?
You know, this came up in a conversation yesterday, and it might be a little tangent, but not too much, I don't think. Is that I think the whole measurement thing, right? Looking at, are we measuring the work that people are doing, and are we really looking at that output and the things that really matter to the business? You know, or are we just tracking unfun things? And I think now more than ever, this also applies to leadership and how teams work externally and understanding what those outputs are, because there's a lot of leaders going, well, how do I be a leader? How do I manage my people from a distance, from afar? How do I track that? How do I know that they're doing the work? And it's like, well, how did you know that they were doing the work before? And if the answer was, I could see them working in the office, then you know you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
At least in our minds, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we have a punch card. They came in at 8:55, and then they took lunch from here to here, and then they punched out at 5:02, and that's how we knew that they were here and doing stuff.
Yes, and they get a gold star on their
report
card.
It can be,
no kidding.
That kind of sounds a little bit like learning complete incomplete.
Yes.
Data. Yep.
Yes.
I was going with it. Yeah. There's that parallel there, right?
Yeah.
You got to measure the right things.
Yep.
Let's maybe take ourselves back to the big thing again, though, because something that we haven't maybe talked about is, because we talk about this idea of learning ecosystems being different than focusing strictly on something that we might call training, whether that's LMS or whatever training it, you know, we think of in that way. But let's talk about some of the benefits, I guess, of shifting to this mindset. Like what kind of opportunities did people find when they start moving to this direction or thinking in this more holistic way?
Mm-hmm. Well, if you set up yourself to have, a good foundation for your ecosystem, which would be your technology and data architecture, that really is the foundation of everything. If you don't have that set up well, you've got your classic garbage in, garbage out of data. Having the perspective on the ecosystem and setting up that foundation well gives you a lot of data. And if you have designed that architecture well and are really focusing on things that you want to be able to capture, measure, and do something with, you have a lot of data to now do stuff with. And that's the real power of the ecosystem. You can do whatever you want with that data. You could create a lot of personalization for folks. So it could for like adaptive learning, as an example, adapting the learning experience automatically as things are progressing, which I'll also add is not necessarily agreed upon in the entire learning industry. There are people who are against that for very good reasons as well, but it is a possibility. But if you also have a governance structure in place who's overseeing the learning ecosystem, it gives them a lot of data to actually make real decisions to affect your overall ecosystem. So really having that data and being able to do something with that data is the real power of this view.
What strikes me is wondering where people find it, because traditionally, you know, training departments didn't really look for this information, right? And so if we're looking to figure out, okay, And you should always start with, what do you have, right? What is the current state look like? Where would somebody go to get a nice, easy to understand picture of their internal tech and data architecture?
Where would they go for that? Well, I would say most folks that I've come across, they haven't mapped it out. So it's something where you might just have to sit down and map it out. There might be somebody in your IT department who deals with integrations between systems, and they may have something already kind of mapped out. But for most folks I've spoken to, they have not actually sat down to map out what my technology system itself looks like and how things are communicating back and forth between each other. But yeah, you got to sit down and do that one.
I guess you probably have to, the first place would be just to simply survey all the things that are doing something related to this. And that sounds kind of, I don't know, that doesn't sound very specific, but just sitting back and just saying, oh, right, we got LMS. Okay, write that down. We got posters on the wall. That's actually part of this whole thing too. We got the hand washing poster now, you know, by the sink or whatever. Yep. All of those things. Oh, we've got that the SharePoint site where people are, you know, stuff lots of things, etc. And just even starting there to even see and think, thinking about it, you know, from that perspective of, I'm using the term survey, but a survey in the sense of looking out over the landscape, as opposed
right,
to
what did the IT guy give you on your orientation day when you first got hired, right? You could start there and just go, okay, you know, what are the icons on my laptop? And like you said, Chris, just get on a whiteboard and just start drawing it out and drawing lines and connect them to each other and put something together, send it to your IT guy and say, hey, does this kind of look like what we have? And they might either just say, yeah, that looks about right. Or they might go, hey, you know what? We've already drawn one of those for you. Here, just take ours.
And I mean, when you're doing that as well, don't forget about the people.
Yeah.
So we want to, so who are your developers? Who are your SMEs? Who are your multimedia developers? Yeah. Don't forget that too.
And then when you've got those different pieces, whether they're tech or non-tech, et cetera, but trying to then identify what it is what role those things are playing, and then what kind of, you know, is there something that you want to track out of that role? You know, what's the suitable thing? And then how do we figure out what that tracking is going to look like and how that relates to things that we can track in, you know, in other places too? Yeah,
definitely. And if there's any opportunity for interoperability between systems.
Yeah. Like Amy's saying, for us, we started with three key problems that needed to be solved. From there, we made interoperability a criteria and decided to leverage XAPI as that standard. Then we were able to hone in on what was needed to solve each problem. Amy, what were the three problems? That would be really cool to know if you've got a heartbeat or a moment to drop that into the chat. That'd be really cool to just help other people understand, you know, where you guys were coming from.
And I know we harped a bit on complete incomplete data, but you might need to start there as a starting point. And that's not a problem at all. I mean, if you're trying to get interoperability between your LMS and another system, maybe SharePoint, you're hosting stuff there and here and here and here, start with that complete incomplete as a starting point to get everything together, all your data into one spot, and then start going into more specific information.
So Amy's saying content management deployment, pushing into other systems, getting data into one data pool, speed up development and implementation. So you guys were, Amy's group was very definitely focused on that, you know, the technology challenges of bringing things together and trying to make sense of it all. Very cool. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Thanks, Amy, for doing that. And but that ties in her last bullet item there, kind of ties into Becky Willis's statement up above. Becky, by the way, former guest of the show. Amy mentioned, so speed up development and implementation, but Becky reminds us that we need to adapt our strategies around that. What does that architecture look like as to, you know, who creates the content? How does it get created? Why does it get created? And what does that workflow look like as learning content solution developers or learning experience developers, whatever we call ourselves in the organization? How do we then fit our work into that data architecture, and how does it all interoperate and all that kind of stuff? So yeah, there's a lot of strategic work that needs to be done, and maybe right now is a good time for people to be doing that.
Yeah, and Amy there mentioned also Lego strategy. So plug and play, you know, add like Lego building blocks on top of perhaps a core system, which LTI is a good option to provide that if your systems are LTI compliant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
Very cool. Very, very cool. Yeah, I mean, Brent was just saying that, you know, in these unusual times, they might actually reveal problems that we might not have known or we might not have worried too much about, but then these things, these problems might now suddenly have a different level of importance than they might have had before. So it would be an opportunity to start thinking about those for sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Kristen is asking in the questions, what are the considerations around accessibility, which is such a critical and important thing to be considering. I mean, lots of tools have some levels of accessibility, but not all of them have a level of universal accessibility that we would like to see. That's for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think with accessibility, it comes down to being able to personalize the experience for everybody as much as possible. I know something called the Next Generation Digital Learning Environment, which is, you can find that on the EdgeCase website. One of their main pillars of that system is accessibility and universal design.
Mm-hmm. And especially if you're actually going to start implementing something new, if you're bringing in something new, then making sure that is the accessibility aspect is already part of that as you're getting started, rather than trying to bolt it on later or thinking about it as we need to, making that a key, you know, evaluation criteria or a key component of why you're bringing in a tool. For sure.
Yeah. You wouldn't happen to have a link to that.
Just threw it in the chat there.
Yeah, oh, there you go.
Hey, way to stay on the ball. I hope everybody doesn't mind if we're going a little bit longer than we normally do, since we got a late start, as long as everybody's okay with that. If we got more questions or if we feel good right now.
Katie's throwing in, it's also a good opportunity to improve the online learning experience when everyone is going through online content. Makes you think about the experience overall, for sure. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No kidding. I mean, all of the things, even technical glitches when you go to get started. What's the process? How does that process look for resolving those things? Or sort of
contingency plans?
Yeah.
You know, maybe. I started calling it, the business continuity planning is an important topic in the business world. There's actually job roles just for business continuity planning. But then when schools all of a sudden shut down, I started thinking, how come nobody's talking about academic continuity planning? And then I just realized, well, geez, everybody's working from home. Everybody is sheltering in place. So it's really lifestyle continuity planning. Did anybody ever actually plan to be doing this? So, yeah. You know, it just kind of levels up and gets really broad. But my point, the reason why I kind of bring that whole thing up is from an ecosystem perspective, right? We can now see, we've now experienced how interconnected so many different things are, especially when we're talking about learning and how do we keep learning happening and what tools are people using. And even though we're still kind of right in the middle of it, I've been encouraging people to start thinking about what could we be doing right now that's going to benefit us 6 weeks, 8 weeks down the road, right? Like consider what the end is going to look like and then think about what we are going to wish we had done, right? Like talk to our people and get data, ask them to maybe keep a journal as to how they did it, like what worked for them and didn't, you know, things like that. I mean, not to get too much off topic, but I think this does tie into ecosystem and us understanding how people are working in that ecosystem structure. And it's what user experience designers and customer experience designers are really good at, that whole research thinking. And as I would encourage folks, if you're in a big enough company that has a UX team, to connect with them and to find out, you know, how they do that kind of stuff and be a part of their world and let them be a part of the learning world, because you're all serving the same people.
Yeah. It certainly pokes a lot of holes in various assumptions that we've been making about the things, you know, that we either make or provide, et cetera, for sure. And hopefully by thinking about that and bringing, you know, resolutions forward, et cetera, we actually, you know, make something that's better all around, not just sort of solving the specifics of the temporal issue that we're all stranded in or working through. So yeah. Amy's saying the data analysis tool and process is a little stuck for us. We have all this data now, but the analysis work is so manual. Haven't sorted out how to automate all of this. Asking for any thoughts on that. So
I mean, there's a lot of companies who are trying to sell part of the analytics. I know some of the LRS companies themselves have analytics as part of their platforms that may be able to help out. But I think it's still a big challenge in the industry. I mean, the business and marketing side of data analytics has been doing this for a long time. And I think the companies now on the learning side are just trying to catch up and mimic some of the stuff they're doing. But I think it's still a big challenge for the industry and how we actually manage that data.
Yeah.
So the one suggestion that I would have when you're trying to set this up would be to be very, very specific at this time as to what kinds of data you're trying to capture to not go way out of scope, make it easier on yourself to manage it.
Yeah. We used to argue with XAPI, you know, take the Google model, right? Capture everything, and then eventually you'll find a use for it or find a way. Maybe not. Maybe focus on the things, because you a mega metric ton of data, but no way to dig into it or analyze it isn't valuable anyway. So
You might not want click data on every single button that exists in an e-learning module. But you might want to know how many people are accessing this specific resource. So you add the data point on that.
Yeah, for sure. And you're part of that factor is, you know, what's the value in knowing this? Because by reporting on it, what information will that give us to give us insight to make other decisions, etc. So
definitely.
Yeah, well, there's a good cue. Joe Cook, good to see you, actually, by the way. But she's also probably cueing us to probably call it a wrap, don't you think, guys? Because we're getting to the top of the hour and everybody's probably got meetings starting up soon.
No, definitely.
Yeah. You know, so
very cool. Well, as always, thanks to everybody who's joined us in the chat. Some really great insights. Amy and Becky, thanks for sharing those your thoughts in the chat. There are lots of things. Make sure you guys check out the link that Derek did pop in. And Derek, thanks so much for joining us here today, prompting some neat thoughts. And it's always interesting to see how things evolve as we're all in this new phase of things and the little blips and such. So, and thanks to everybody for their patience for us getting started today. The squirrels finally were all running apparently in the same order and in the same direction, and we got that metric imperial peanut solution in place. So hopefully we'll have that for next week too. So awesome.
And if folks want more information, I think you guys had linked the paper in the invite for the crowdcast.
It's in the invite. So yeah,
you can drop that stuff into the chat too if you want before we go Eric, and even after we're done here, while the numbers are crunching in the background here and the recording gets saved here, you can still go into the chat and drop stuff in, folks. These things stay live in crowdcast, so you can always come back and watch the recording and rescan the chat just in case you were wondering.
Yeah, for sure. All right, well, thanks everybody, let's dance out of here.
Yeah, good times. Thanks, everybody. Thank you, Derek. Great to see you.
Thanks so much.
It just wouldn't be without a double Z. Get it up there.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of your life.